Hello friends, now let's begin with part 2 of module 20 under the title Theories of Normative and Applied Ethics, Western Perspective. Ethics is a branch of philosophy. It is also called moral philosophy because it deals with the idea of morally right and wrong human behavior. Human actions and behaviors are analyzed, described, and guided from various perspectives and standpoints. The term ethics is derived from the Greek word ethos, that basically refers to habit, custom, way of behavior, and so on. The word moral is derived from the Latin word mores, which also signifies customs and character. Thus, ethics can be understood as a methodological study and examination of human behavior from the standpoint of their rightfulness and wrongfulness. It is a reflective analysis of what is good and what is bad in human conduct, for human bear some personal responsibilities. Hence, it can be said that ethics analyzes what is good and right along with the way to achieve it, and what is wrong or bad and the ways to avoid it. As a philosophical study, ethics is defined as the critical analysis of the values and ways in which humans live and act. Rather than just following a custom or tradition, it comprises of the evaluation and justification of these guidelines and values with reference to some universal principles. It involves critical and philosophical consideration about morality, moral dilemmas, moral problems, moral conceptions, and judgments. In order to understand ethics, it is important to note that ethics has both theoretical and practical dimensions. Former in the sense of providing fundamental principles as the basis of moral judgments, and the latter in the sense of being concerned about what is to be achieved and how it is to be achieved. There are multiple definitions of ethics that are further employed in various fields of human actions, but the most famous philosophical theories of ethics are classified into following three broad categories, that is normative ethics, applied ethics, and metaethics. It is beyond the scope of this module to discuss every aspect of concerned issue. However, an attempt will be made to make it as inclusive as possible. In analytic philosophy, ethics is distinguished in the following levels. First, metaethics. Second, normative ethics. And third, applied ethics. Generally speaking, normative ethics involves specific positions concerning how to act, what ought and what ought not to be done, what is right and wrong, and so on. For instance, is it morally wrong to kill someone? It attempts to provide universal guidelines governing human actions by regulating the content of our own actions. Further, applied ethics is an attempt to apply the broad moral principles in particular, complex and often controversial situations such as abortion, euthanasia, animal rights, business ethics, medical ethics, media ethics, environmental concerns, infanticides, etc. There are some examples of the areas that come under the field of applied ethics. Another significant branch of ethics is metaethics. It analyzes the nature of ethics and moral judgments as well as moral reasoning. It is concerned with answering the second order questions. For example, when we say killing is always wrong, it further brings us to the underlying question, which is whether ethical principles are relative or objective. What exactly does the word wrong mean? How to define moral concepts such as right, wrong, good, bad, and so on? All the above three fields of ethics are differentiated as well as interrelated with each other and cannot be understood exclusive of the other. Now let's move on to explain you the objective of the module. This module will primarily deal with the ethical theories and present moral dilemmas which we face in our day-to-day life. It will try to explore the interaction between moral practices and ethical reflection. Thus, this module will largely be focusing on applied ethics. In order to trace these views, this module has been divided into 5 sections, which covers the few important areas of applied ethics, where lot of work is being done presently. Although various issues have been dealt upon in this module, it is a limited approach to the issue and justice cannot be done due to limited space. This module works as a mere introduction to these issues. Now let's talk about applied ethics. Moral problems occur in all areas of life, professional, personal, and political. Should bank impose strict criterion on clients to promote corporate social responsibilities? How to allocate fairly the benefits and burdens of climate change policy options? Is it ethical for us to use biological enhancement technologies to make us better in some respect? For what purpose is the use of big data morally permissible? Such problems require careful reflection on the facts, but also on our basic moral values. Applied ethics is the branch of ethics which investigates the application of ethical theories in actual life scenarios. To this end, applied ethics attempts to illuminate the possibility of disagreement about the ways theories and principles should be applied. Specific areas of applied ethics are medical ethics, bioethics, public sector ethics, welfare ethics, business ethics, decision-making ethics, legal ethics, which is also known as justice, media ethics, environmental ethics, computer ethics, and robot ethics. Now let's talk about applied ethics and its growth. Human beings are naturally moral and engage in social interaction. Their daily routine constitutes of making several judgments on moral issues. For instance, a human being often contemplates on what is right and wrong, what one should do, or what is valuable for oneself and other selves. Now, these questions are also often contentious and involves dilemma. We rely upon ethics when we start making moral judgments on these issues. We tend to check whether our moral judgments can be justified from all the perspectives. Hence, we see ethics as a reflection on morality. In social contexts, lot of moral judgments are made and a lot of moral acts are performed, such as in areas of healthcare, environmental sustenance, assigning values to non-humans, politics, education, etc. In the domain of health, moral issues are related to life and death and human well-being. We often raise questions such as, are all life-saving measures acceptable? In politics, there are often judgments concerning value conflicts. The decision maker is compelled to choose an alternative. When we reflect on these type of decision making, we touch upon applied ethics. So applied ethics is concerned with crucial part of human life and social development. James Childress defines applied ethics as follow. The term applied ethics and practical ethics are used interchangeably to indicate the application of ethics to special arenas of human activity such as business, politics, medicine, and to particular problems such as abortion. The field of applied ethics flourished only in 1970s. Prior to this, we have seen moral philosophers concerned only with conceptual and epistemological questions. Normative ethics also did not do much to analyze moral problems in this sense. In a famous expression, philosopher Stephen Tolman said that medicine saved the life of ethics. Medicine saved the life of ethics. New and accurate moral problem in medicine that have no ready-to-hand answers are explored by ethicists pursuing bioethics, which comes under applied ethics. Also, secularization of Western world meant fewer people looked up to church for the answers. Max Weber says, moral heteronomy gave way to moral autonomy. Individuals were free to formulate their answers. Secondly, development of applied ethics relates to new moral problems faced by society as a consequence of new technologies and their impact. No new legal and moral concepts lead to policy vacuum. It's because of these factors, applied ethics assumed a very important role and it is an ever-expanding field. Medicine and healthcare were starting points, and politics and business followed. Now, more and more human activities are assessed from an ethical point of view. Farming, animal breeding, technology, information and communication technology ethics, politics and ethics, food environment, media, etc. Now the question arises, does theory always go hand in hand with practice? Are theoretical norms always worthy of application in real life situations? The philosophers who come in the realm of applied ethics mainly take interest into these questions. The areas of applied ethics which are most researched are environmental ethics and bioethics, which encompasses clinical medical ethics, media ethics, food ethics, etc., which are also briefly discussed here. Let's first start discussing environmental ethics. From the beginning of human habitation on this planet, human beings have presumed that all the resources available in nature are for the sake of meeting their personal needs. The environment has been overexploited for carrying out one's selfish motives and desires without any sense of gratitude or resolve for its restoration. It is only in the recent years that an awareness and an attempt to protect the environment has come up. But the motive behind this awareness is also anthropocentric. Such awareness can be traced back to the anxiety of depriving the future generation of all the judicious resources of the planet. Thus, human beings are trying to protect the planet only with the goal of sustainable development. As opposed to this, the sense in which the environmental ethicists argue for environmental justice differs from the sociologists. Although the reference which aims at protection of environment in both the cases is the same. Since ethics, which is an essential domain of philosophy, distinguishes between the moral concepts of right and wrong, or between the meta-ethical concepts of good and evil, based on ascription of values, moral virtues and imperatives, environmental ethics has prospered as a new domain of philosophy only as a result of critiquing anthropocentrism, which only ascribes intrinsic value to human beings. The environmental ethicists have challenged anthropocentrism by firstly questioning the preconceived moral supremacy of human beings over the entire ecosystem. They have also dwelled into the prospect of rationality, ascribing non-anthropocentric intrinsic value to various species of the ecosystem and also to the ecosystem as a whole. It is this inquiry of environmental ethicist in determining environmental justice on the basis of ascribing intrinsic value or inherent rights to the environment that constitute environmental ethics. On the basis of ascription of value, there are different positions within environmental ethics. So let's start discussing them. First is anthropocentrism. The term basically signifies the humans must be considered at the center of and above any other aspect of reality when it comes to assigning values. This concept can be termed as human centricism or human supremacy. This anthropocentric view is considered to be the central problem for all the present environmental issues present in the world today. The use of the word dominion used in Genesis, where God purportedly gives man dominion over all creature, is controversial. John Passmore's Man's Responsibility Towards Nature has been severely criticized by defenders of deep ecology. Second is biocentrism. The entire branch of environmental ethics developed as a reaction to anthropocentrism. Biocentrism was the one of the first approaches to develop. The term biocentrism comes from Greek word bios, which means life, and kentron, which means center. It basically extends the status of moral object from human beings to all living things in nature. Biocentric ethics call for a change in assessing the relationship between humans and nature. Biocentrists observe that all species have inherent value and that humans are not superior to other species in a moral or ethical sense. All living beings are interdependent and pursue their own good. The proponents of this view hold that all biological species have an inherent value and thus should be given moral consideration by virtue of possessing these qualities. The advocates of biocentrism also support animal rights, environmental protection, and preservation of diversity. It finds support even by deep ecologists like Arne Nies. This view is primarily supported by Albert Schweitzer in his work Reverence for Life, Peter Singer's Ethics for Animal Liberation, Paul Taylor's view of biocentric egalitarianism, etc. Now let's talk about animal ethics as explained by Peter Singer's argument from sentience. Peter Singer's most significant contribution in the domain of environmental ethics can be defined in terms of his argument from sentience. Unlike most ethicists, Singer does not consent in holding rationality as the basic criterion for moral consideration, as there are a lot of human beings who also don't qualify for this criterion. Thus, Singer assesses that the criterion for moral considerability should be modified to sentience, which is common to all moral beings. Now, whether a being is sentient or can be only determined by his or her capability to suffer or experience pain. Since both humans and non-human animals have equal capacity of suffering or feeling pain, there is no moral justification to show that humans suffer more than the animals. They should be given equal moral consideration as human beings through the act of assigning them with human rights. Now, here is another perspective presented by Tom Regan. Tom Regan is an American moral philosopher and a radical animal ethicist. Tom Regan's paper, The Case for Animal Rights, is a critique of thinkers who deny the rights of animals. Thus, indirect duty view states that we owe nothing to the animals and can never do an act which wrong them. Therefore, we have indirect duties rather than direct duties towards them. For example, if a person kicks my dog, he will be harming my property and not the dog. Thus, the duty of the man to my dog is indirect. This is refused by Regan on the following grounds. To justify this view, it has to be ensured that the dog doesn't feel any pain and is not hurt by the man. But this statement is false. As animals are conscious beings, they experience pain and there is no justification otherwise. If it is considered that animals do not feel pain by the ethicist, it should also be accepted that humans too do not feel any pain. Some may also say that both man and dog feel pain when the dog is kicked, but the pain felt by human is the one which matters. This argument is rejected by Regan and states it as completely irrational. Pain is pain, and we cannot be rationally discard the moral significance of pain that animals experiences. According to Regan, every man has some intrinsic values. These values are not dependent on external factors. As a result, the conscious beings should be valued for the sake of its own. As animals are also self-conscious, they experience subjects which possess inherent value and thus are obliged to be treated equally. Regan is against the view of where cosmetic experiments is considered wrong, but using them for medical research is acceptable. This kind of partial attribution is rejected. Now let's move on to discuss the third element called ecocentric perspective. This term comes from the synthesis of two Greek words, oikos meaning house and kentron meaning center. This view extends inherent value to the entirety of the ecosystem and focuses on preservation of the biosphere as a totality, including species, population, land, and ecosystem. The proponents of this theory believes that the entire universe is integrated into a unified whole. As a result of this, each and every part of ecology should be given its due respect. This view is in contrast to anthropocentrism and accommodates animal ethics, biocentrism, ecocentrism, which within its own scope and therefore the most effective from the perspective of environmental ethics. This view was conceived by Aldo Leopold in his work A Sand County Almanac, written in 1949, where he propounds his theory of land ethics. A thing is right when it tends to preserve the integrity, stability, and beauty of the biotic community. It is wrong when it tends otherwise. This view was endorsed by Arnenis and Georg Sessions and finds its expression in the first principle of deep ecology. Now let us discuss what you mean by deep ecology. This movement was born in Scandinavia as a result of the discussion between Arnenis, Sigmund Quale and Nils Fjellner. This theory is inspired by Spinoza's metaphysics, which talks about rejection of atomistic individualism, the idea that human being is a separate self-possessing essence different from the rest of the world, not only divorces human from the rest of the world, but also induces selfishness towards nature. Nies, contrary to this view, suggests that humans should adopt relational total field image of the world. According to this view, humans are best understood as knots in the biospherical net. This view focuses on identification of human ego with nature. Let's start with ecofeminism. This term ecofeminism was first coined by Françoise Dibon in 1974. Feminist theories try to analyze the reason for women's operation, its chief causes and consequences, and suggest strategies for improvement. Few feminist writers suggested that patriarchal mode of thinking encouraged not only subjugating and colonizing women, but it extended to people of color, nature, and also animals. Sheila Collins further adds that male-dominated culture is supported by four interlocking pillars of sexism, racism, class exploitation, and ecological destruction. Val Plumwood, an important eco-feminist thinker, understands that oppressive structure which dominate women in one of the many parallel structures and the common ideological rhetorical device to justify the position of privilege. The oppressive structure generally creates value dualisms, hierarchical thinking which only subjugates female values. The dualistic way of thinking sees the world in polar opposite terms like man-women, active-passive, mind-body, reason-emotion, transcendent-immanent, human-animal, culture-nature. This kind of duality reflects the inferiority of the lower term. Karen Warren, Nestra King, Vandana Shiva are few prominent thinkers who have contributed significantly in this area. Now let's talk about media ethics, which is an important pillar under this topic. Almost everyone across the globe today consent on the fact that media is corrupt and indulges in unethical practices. Historically, media was not expected to be objective in nature. The American press in the initial years were never accurate or completely honest in their reporting. It is only post the Civil War and a chain of protest against dishonest journalism in America that journalists began to adhere to an ethical code of conduct, since that became the need of the hour as everyone wanted to have a fair idea of both sides of the story. Also in the beginning of the 20th century, newspaper became the most resourceful medium of mass communication. As a result of this, yellow journalism was questioned and the public demanded professionalism. Concept of truth, transparency objectively became part of the code of conduct prescribed for journalists. In the 20th century, we can once again see a return of the old unethical practices in journalism. Media is biased and unreliable in their reporting. Public has lost all the trust it had on media in general. The main issue is that the public is unable to make a distinction between fact and opinion. Thus, today media ethics has developed as a separate subject in the domain of applied ethics to deal with all the questions pertaining to truth, maximizing harm, accountability of media, etc. to stop this problem from further aggravating. Now, the next one is business ethics. Business ethics comprises of the basic moral standard every employee should adhere to while he or she is part of an organization. It is the ethical code of conduct prescribed for interpersonal communication or transaction between two companies or clients, or intrapersonal communication or way of working inside a professional zone. It also pays special attention to the working condition of workers. For instance, is it ethical for companies put the life of the workers at stake by making them work in industries, manufacturing crackers or drugs, etc.? Thus, business ethics is largely essential for the protection of the rights of the workers. Is a company justified in making its workers work for extra hours without pay? Is there a criteria required for companies to stick to in determining the salaries of its workers? These are the ethical questions which are catered to in the domain of business ethics. Next is again one of the emerging branch of applied ethics known as clinical bioethics. This area of research deals with the various ethical conflicts which are taking place specifically in the practice of medicine. It tries to resolve conflicts between the best interest of the physician versus the best interest of the patient, clashes between the autonomy of the physician and patient. It deals with concepts like moral consent. This is the most important part of any medical intervention, starting from euthanasia to organ transplant to abortion. Just distribution of medical resources in cases of organ transplantation. What is the moral criterion of fair and just distribution of organs? What should be the determining factor when the demand surpasses the rate of supply? Can age be the criterion? Should the chances of survival be the determining criteria? Conflict of saving life or taking life in cases of abortion. In cases of abortion, how do we morally weigh pro-life over pro-choice? This means, should we respect the autonomy of the mother more than the life of the fetus or vice versa? For example, euthanasia, whether voluntary euthanasia is synonymous to killing and therefore unethical, whether involuntary and non-voluntary euthanasia is justified in cases where the patient is incapable of giving consent. In such cases, are patients or family members eligible in taking this life-taking decision? Also, what is the measure to determine whether the doctor's decision is unbiased and only in the best interest of the patient? Now let's discuss food ethics and food. It is no secret that food is by far the most essential human need, and as a result, the topic of eating food attracts a certain concern about the ways food is produced and how it is consumed. To put it crudely, when the question of survival is at stake, there is no other need as necessary as the consumption of food. There was a time when the relation between food and hunger was a direct stimulus output one, where one would eat anything to satiate the hunger one felt, and the function of food was to simply prevent starvation. However, over the past centuries, food has also come to mean a number of things. Some associate food as strengthening social and cultural ties, and other considers eating a leisure activity, implying an activity from which pleasure can be derived. Some have come to view food as a personal preference. For other, it is a product produced to cater to the wants of consumer. In the past, food was associated very clearly with a sense of morality, such that what one ate became the judge of how spiritual or good a person was. Within certain communities and religious traditions, there is a clear list of food items that are considered permissible and those that are forbidden for consumption. The talk on food is new structured in accordance with issues prevalent with food itself, instead of being related to other issues like spirituality and character building. This point has also been made in the introduction to Food and Philosophy by Fritz Alouf and Dave Monroe, where they say, "We support the thesis that food is and ought to be a proper object of philosophical investigation in its own right." A good question to ask at this point is, what is food ethics? The term food ethics was coined by Ben Mepham in 1996, and as the name suggests, the food ethics is a discipline that deals with eating ethically. To put it simply, food ethics is a new field in applied ethics which is concerned with developing, analyzing, and understanding ethical questions in the production, packaging, preparing, storing, distributing, and advertising, as well as consumption of food in a way that borrows from a variety of disciplines and areas, giving the discipline an interdisciplinary character. Lot of work in present is happening in the area of GM modification, production, demand, animal cloning, and commercial production to meet the present needs. Now, while concluding the above theme, analysis of the fact-value relationship is important. After looking into a detailed account of all the branches of ethics, we have finally come down to the most intriguing meta-ethical question, which in a way reconciles all the three major approaches of ethics. This question is concerning the fact-value relationship. Is what is the case descriptive necessarily related to what ought to be the case normative and further applied? Can value judgments be deduced from a set of factual statements? On through research, we find two diametrically opposed views on this issue. One view maintains that there is a sharp distinction between factual statements and value judgments, such that the latter cannot be derived from the former. The other view maintains that a sharp distinction between the factual statements and value judgment does not exist, and value judgment can be derived from factual statements. Philosophers like David Hume believed in the former view. He believes that although we begin with factual statements which are bereft of any moral predicates, such as statements about God, we are then told that with reference to the current state of affairs, we ought to act in such and such a way. This, according to Hume, is not a legitimate argument, since the conclusion contains a novel relation which is absent in the premises. In contrast to this, there are various meta-ethicists such as Glish, Philippa Foot, who admit that factual statements are rejected to ethical judgments. Glish begins with the analysis with expressions such as good and evil. For him, the meaning of good is context sensitive and it alters with the changing context. Good is multifunctional in nature. When we say good wife and good knife, we naturally do not have the same implication. A good knife is one which fulfills the purpose of cutting, whereas a good wife is one who takes care of her husband. These various ongoing irresolvable conflicts have generated scope for further research in ethics and is also preventing the entire subject from becoming obsolete. Interest in applied ethics have increased during the last decades. Applied ethics is an academic discipline analyzing moral problems in different social arenas. Applied ethics is often worked on in collaboration between philosophers and academics from other disciplines and with professionals who are affected by a moral problem. The turn to applied ethics can basically be explained by three main factors known as secularization. Unquestionable moral authorities no longer exist. Moral decisions are taken autonomously, and in the public discussion on moral issues, a demand for expertise in applied ethics exists. Second, due to advent of technologies, for example, in healthcare, the consumerist behavior society faces new and difficult moral problems. A public awareness is needed on how to handle new moral dilemmas. Third, many people are engaged in struggles for social justice, sustainability, animal rights, and other causes. Applied ethics can contribute to the understanding of this type of typical social and political issues. Now, here are some learning outcomes of this module. This module is meant to discuss the issues related to understanding moral theories, ethics, and its practice in the actual world to the present problem. It aims at achieving the following outcomes. It brings out the main argument mentioned by various significant ethicists, thinker. Applied ethics offer an in-depth focus on the interaction between moral practice and ethical theories, allowing you to explore ethical theories in relation to actual practical dilemma. It deals with the historical development of the applied ethics, which presents how the issue of the right and liberties of the concerned has been the focal point in the ethical and moral discourses. This knowledge in the area of applied ethics provides theoretical background in ethics. It deals with the historical development of the applied ethics, which presents how the issue of the right and liberties of concerned has been the focal point in the ethical and moral discourses. This knowledge in the area of applied ethics provides theoretical background in ethics, including important methods and debates in applied ethics. It enables one to understand and deliberate in a logical way. The views of different kinds of ethical positions show that there is no one way of looking at this issue, and several efforts have been made to destroy the archaic way of looking at the people. It will also enable us to understand the implications of legal and political frameworks for ethical argumentation. The interdisciplinary approach offers one multiple avenue of investigation into applied ethics. In addition to studying philosophy, one will learn about the context in which moral problems arise and the different types of analysis that may be needed in various contexts. It will also examine how viewpoints from different disciplines can strengthen ethical reflection and argumentation. This module is research-driven and focuses on human dignity, environmental ethics, animal ethics, sustainability ethics, health ethics, bioethics, media ethics, and food ethics. This module has tried to present the philosophical discussion over the issue at hand. This enriches one's knowledge of how philosophy has contributed significantly in this realm. The deontological, consequentialist, utilitarian views throw light on how, by applying various philosophical positions, we can understand and analyze the issue of ethical dilemmas, which can be handled in a better way. I hope you really enjoyed this module, had some learning, and thank you for being with us.